डियर शॉर्ट हैंड राइटर्स, दिस इज इंग्लिश शॉर्ट हैंड डिक्टेशन नंबर 161 एंड द डिक्टेशन स्पीड इज 120 वर्ड्स पर मिनट. रेडी स्टार्ट. आई एम हैप्पी टू होस्ट द सेलिब्रेशन ऑन दिस ग्रेट ओकेजन एज पार्ट ऑफ आवर सिविलाइजेशनल जर्नी फॉर वेलफेयर ऑफ द यूनिवर्स सिंस टाइम इमेमोरियल. इट वॉज ऑन दिस डे some 2500 years ago that the word of wisdom was spoken out for the first time. On attaining enlightenment, the Buddha spent 5 weeks in a state beyond description. Then he started sharing with people the nectar he had discovered. It was in Sarnath, in the eastern part of India, that the Buddha preached his first sermon to his 5 original disciples. It was a momentous occasion unparalleled in the history of humankind. The video message by the Prime Minister of India, seen by all of us just now, reflects the eternal values and positive approach of India. I am delighted at the very enriching message from the President of Mongolia read out by the Ambassador. I had the privilege to host the President of Mongolia as our honored guest during his state visit in September last year. It was an occasion for us to deepen our civilizational friendship and to nourish our age-old Buddhist ties. I am told that the International Buddhist Confederation, with its presence in 36 countries, is holding the celebrations around the world. However, we are in the midst of a virulent pandemic that has overwhelmed the entire humanity. Perhaps no part of the world remains untouched by this calamity that adversely affects every individual. As a precaution, we have to follow certain discipline and maintain physical distance. The International Buddhist Confederation is therefore holding the events virtually. I believe that such an effort is praiseworthy because this makes it possible for a far larger number of people from all corners of the world to participate in them. Ceremonies and prayers are being organized at the sacred sites in India, Sri Lanka, Mongolia, and many other countries where IBC has its presence. Let us remind ourselves that the Buddha's first sermon was disarmingly simple. That sermon has a unique place in the Buddhist canon. Both practitioners and scholars revere it as the treasure in which the entire teaching is hidden. For 45 years after he attained enlightenment, the Buddha traveled across the vast regions of the Gangetic Plains to bring the healing message to the masses. Thus, he delivered a very large number of discourses. Ironically, the Buddha's teaching was against the current during those times, but the force of his argument was woven around love, compassion and non-violence. The spread of Buddhism around the world was guided by these eternal values. In his lifetime, he always sought to convince people through his logical and moral arguments. The Buddha always held that to force oneself to believe and accept a thing without understanding is political and not spiritual or intellectual. This is the precise reason that in his first sermon, the Buddha advises the 5 original disciples to shun the extreme methods and prefer the middle path. Then he speaks of the ultimate reality as given in the 4 noble truths, as summation of the human condition as well as human potential. These 4 noble truths are unmatched in any tradition, spiritual or literary, in entire history. After the diagnosis of our ailment, the Buddha prescribes the medicine, which is the eightfold path to enlightenment. It is a complete and perfect way of life. The 8 steps are right view, right thought, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. Thus, the wheel of truth was set in motion. Ever since, it has been the lodestar, helping spiritual seekers navigate through the maze of worldly life and arrive at the end of suffering, here and now. It is so scientific that it resembles psychotherapy more than a traditional dogmatic religion. It is this open attitude of inquiry into the heart of existence and the possibility of finding the key to eternal serenity that has attracted seekers in every age for the last 2500 years. The wheel has come full circle, and the teachings of the Buddha have in the recent decades spread to distant shores in the West too. India is proud of being the land of origin of the Dhamma. It was from India that it began to spread in neighboring regions. There, in new fertile soil and new climate, it grew organically, eventually branching off into various offshoots. In India, we see Buddhism as a fresh expression of the sublime truth. His enlightenment and the subsequent preaching by him for over four decades were in line with India's tradition of respect for intellectual liberalism and spiritual diversity. In modern times, two exceptionally great Indians, Mahatma Gandhi and Baba Sahab Ambedkar, found inspiration in the words of the Buddha and went on to shape the destiny of the nation. Following in their footsteps, we should strive to hear the call of the Buddha, to respond to his invitation to walk the noble path. The world seems full of suffering in short term as well as in long term. There are many stories of kings and affluent people suffering from acute depression who took refuge in the Buddha to escape cruelties of life. Indeed, the life of the Buddha challenges earlier convictions as he believed in finding a deliverance from suffering in the midst of this imperfect world. Today, as the pandemic ravages human lives and economies across the globe, the Buddha's message serves like a beacon. He advised people to shun greed, hatred, violence, jealousy, and many other vices to find happiness. Contrast this message with the hankering of an unrepentant mankind indulging in the same old violence and degradation of nature. We all know that the moment the virulence of coronavirus slows down, we have a far more serious challenge of climate change before us. Mahatma Gandhi, our father of the nation, knew that the Buddha offered a way out of our present predicament. The Buddha taught us what is known as the right path, and to learn the right path is not merely to pack our brains with many things that sound nice, good, and sweet, but to do the right things. The Buddha was so filled with mercy and kindness that it was he who taught us to love not only the members of the human family, but also to love all life, to love all the animal world. He also taught us the personal purity of life. In the final phase of his life, the Buddha was acutely conscious of the fact that egotism driven by envy, hatred, greed, and ambition would undermine compassion and kindness. The Buddha therefore encouraged the culture of dialectic and debate among his followers to arrive at their own truth. His cure for human suffering remains as relevant today as it was over 2.5 millennia ago. There is no doubt that the urgency of abiding by the values that the Buddha preached is eternal. By ignoring the soothing wisdom of every spiritual tradition, we have arrived at the juncture where we find ourselves today. It is high time we paid heed. I am grateful to the International Buddhist Confederation for providing me the opportunity to host this event, and also to share my thoughts with you.